All right, welcome along to a special Team 33, just with what's coming up at the weekend, with Liverpool potentially going for first Premier League title since 1990, and obviously a comeback during the week where they beat Barcelona 4-0 at Anfield on those special kind of European nights. Marcus Maher, who is a biased Liverpool fan, also a filmmaker, also has been involved in cycling and other pursuits as well, and has been on this show many a time, and also did our Iceland documentary some time ago. He's back with us. He's in Barcelona at the moment, so he probably gauged the mood in the city at the time after Tuesday night. Marcus, welcome along, and what was the mood like?
Hey Ralph, how are you doing?
Yeah, not bad. What was the mood like in Barcelona after the remontada that has been done to them by Liverpool?
You're talking about the remontada. Are you talking about the first game, or are you talking about the second game? It all depends on the perspective.
Second game, particularly. I think we've moved on to that point.
Yeah, well, let's just say it was pretty funeral-like. You know, there was a lot of the shirts had disappeared off the streets. The pre game, they were all out in the streets celebrating as if they'd already reached Madrid. Come the next day, they were completely, you know, silent by their absence. So it was pretty funeral-like procession. That's for sure.
Yeah. Now, we were actually due to chat last week, but just timings didn't really work out. But what the piece was going to be was really the whole idea of Liverpool being more than a club, because that obviously links into the whole Barcelona thing. Liverpool is more than a club, but you could say that about most football clubs as well at the same time. But the whole area and football culture around Liverpool, so you would have grown up there, of course. And
sure.
I had an impression maybe there's that whole thing about like some people from Merseyside being kind of Liverpool first and English second. Obviously, you're Irish, as you would consider yourself, but yeah. Is that a true kind of perception?
Yeah, I think, you know, Liverpool have always had this sort of, it's always been a dilemma in Liverpool purely because of its industrial past, really, Raf. You know, it's mercantile past, it's seafaring past. So it's not really a city that's really, you know, considered typically English because of its geography as well, you know. If you see Liverpool's location, it's kind of looking, well, it's looking virtually out to the Irish Sea, out to Dublin, really, or up to Holyhead. So it's your geographical location, really, to begin with, really puts it very much at odds as a typically sort of Anglo-Saxon city, you know. So in terms of its history, in terms of its, you know, its sort of its past, it's a city that's really been sort of very much pushed to the environs, to the outskirts of England. So really, in that respect, geographically and almost sort of topographically, it's a city that's really very different to many, many cities in England, you know?
Yeah, and I suppose growing up there, and you can give away your age as well in terms of what era we're talking about here, but...
Yeah, I was born in the 70s, so... Yeah, I mean, I was just a boy when the Liverpool glory years were, you know, were in full flow, and I saw the team progress all the way through the late 70s into the early 80s, up until about 1990. I was still in my, you know, still quite young, and you know, we're going to touch obviously on this weekend and how long it's been since Liverpool have won an actual Premier League title. I never ever thought, if someone had said to me back in 1990, a young lad, like, you know, Liverpool are never going to win the league for the next 30 years, I would have just, you know, called the funny farm and locked you up, you know?
Yeah. No, but even the football geography, you mentioned the topography and all that there. Like, yeah. we've had a lot of kind of Liverpudlian players on the show, from the likes of Robbie Fowler, yep, to Fairclough as well, who would have been from that 70s era, the kind of super sub. He, in his book, when we interviewed him, he was talking about a place called Cantrell Farm, so that's where he kind of grew up. So would you know all those kind of areas, and is there a way?
I grew up, actually, Raf, you know, where I was born, actually geographically, I was born very much in the centre of Liverpool. I was born in an area called Old Swan. It's actually where Ron Atkinson comes from, would you believe? Big Ron, you know?
Yeah, we've had Big Ron on the show, so I know.
In terms of its geography, you couldn't get more of a scouser than me, really, in terms of where I was from, because I'm actually very much from the centre of Liverpool, which basically divides the city between the waterside front, which is down towards the docks, and also the south side of Liverpool, which is, I guess if people are from Dublin, you would kind of look at from the River Liffey, you would kind of look at the north side to the south side. So I was very much from the north side of Liverpool, which is not that far away from Cantrell Farm. I would say it was probably about 2 or 3 kilometers from Cantrell Farm. So where I was from, Old Swan, the area actually is very much central Liverpool. So in that respect, you know, you couldn't get more Scouse than me, you know?
Yeah, well, I can tell from the accent, and I always could from back in the day, even 10 years ago. But I remember you told me years ago that I think you played against Steve McManaman's youth team at one point.
I did. I played in a Sunday League game against him. He played for a team called Diamonds. I used to play for a Sunday League team. And I wasn't a bad footballer myself, Rafa. I've got to give myself credit there, you know, on the right wing. And you know, we'd heard before the match, there was this really hot guy playing, you know, this really prospective Liverpool player. And my team is actually a team called, ironically, you wouldn't believe this, team called Leinster, would you believe? Because around the area I was from in Liverpool, we had a Sunday League team and Sunday League teams, and they were all called either Leinster or Munster or Donegal. So there's a lot of Irish there in terms of the connection. And I played for the team Leinster, and we played this team Diamonds, and sure enough, there was Steve McManaman on the opposing side, and you could see straight away. I mean, he was exceptional. You know, you could see gangly, thin, wiry player, but he had all the skills and all the ability. And I knew even back then at 13, 14 that this guy was going to be something special, you know.
Yeah, and a lot of footballers have emerged from that region, obviously from Wayne Rooney on the Everton side of things, Ross Barkley. Yeah.
Well, Wayne Rooney actually is from Stephen Gerrard. They're actually from the Cantrell Farm, you know, sort of Dovecot area. They're actually from that sort of that little area in Liverpool, little pocket. Robbie Fowler's actually from an area you won't believe, it's called Dingle. It's not the Dingle in Kerry, by the way, but the Dingle in Liverpool, which people get a bit confused with. And McManaman is actually from the south side as well, Allerton, around that way, you know?
Yeah. As you kind of touched on geographic divisions there, the city obviously isn't really split in terms of Everton's on one side, Liverpool on the other. So it's more kind of even within families, I guess, there are, you know, splits.
It is. I mean, ironically, Raf, you know, I'm a big Liverpool supporter, but, you know, I when I was a boy growing up, I actually did watch Everton games. And Everton were a really good team in the mid to late 80s. So in terms of, you know, football identity, you've got a very much, you know, blue side, red side. But I think a lot of that would be within families more than sort of, you know, pockets of areas, really. Whereas in areas in Glasgow, for example, you would have it very much in areas, you know, Govan or maybe the east side, East Kilbride, and sort of that side of Glasgow. But in Liverpool, it really doesn't have that division, you know. It's very much within families, very much within the you know, the people growing up in an Everton family or a Liverpool family, you know. Ironically, you know, Fowler and McManaman were both Everton fans growing up, so there you go, you know.
Yeah, and one of the things also recently, we had Stig Inge Bjørneby on the show, so the former Norway footballer who was Liverpool left back for a few years, and I think as we, like I chatted to you a bit before we did the interview actually about the Dockers strike, and there is a connection, a football community kind of connection between both clubs, Liverpool and Everton, and the people. And that's one of those examples of how that manifests itself. You wouldn't have been there around that time, would you?
No, I would. I've been living away from Liverpool a long, long time, and I studied in the University of Liverpool, but I you know, haven't really been literally in the city. I spent most of my time in Ireland, in Dublin, you know, so that's really where I see myself as being Irish. But in terms of Liverpool, everyone knows about the Dockers strike. It was a very divisive strike that went on for 3 years between 1995 and 1998. And, you know, it brought, again, as what happened with Hillsborough, it brought people together in terms of Liverpool's a very militant city like that, you know. It brings people together, and that dispute was very much not out of the headlines in Liverpool, and because every day down by the Mersey Harbour and docks, company down in the dock side of Liverpool, very much, you know, they were there. The guys I was on strike, you know, every day for 2.5-3 years nearly, Raf, you know. So it's very much still remembered in Liverpool, you know.
Yeah, and I mean, I suppose touching on this weekend and obviously pitching ahead to a Champions League final as well, it's not a team full of local lads, the current one. I mean, there's a lot of English players, but in terms of actual Scousers, there's not too many. Maybe one person, obviously, who is one representative and was very crucial in both of the last two games, the win over Newcastle and then the Barcelona comeback, Trent Alexander-Arnold. Is it important for Liverpoolians, and particularly Liverpool fans, to have that local connection in the team?
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't help, does it? I mean, if you've got a local lad like Gerrard or like Carragher playing in Liverpool, you know, it gives that sense of solidity in terms of its identity. But, you know, football today, and I've touched on this with you before in previous podcasts, is that, you know, it's very much a global game. It's more of a bonus now that we've got a guy from Liverpool, and especially that young, and especially, you know, coming through the ranks. It's very unusual today. I mean, 20 years ago, I don't think that would have been considered such a rare thing, but it's getting rarer and rarer, I feel, Raf, you know, and it's great because he's an exceptional talent. And you know, at 20 years of age, he's got a long road ahead of him in terms of improving. I mean, if he can be this good at 20, you know, what is he going to be like at 26? So, you know, of course, in Liverpool, you know, what I like about Trent Alexander-Arnold, he's a very, we like to think like myself, you know, very level-headed, down-to-earth guy. You know, he doesn't get ahead of himself. There's not a lot of ego with him. And I think that's down to either his family and also the culture inside the club, you know, which nurtures people to learn how to be an upstanding person in the community. And I think that's you know, he's a great ambassador for Liverpool, I feel.
Yeah, and obviously Anfield being the temple, which brings people in. So your experiences of games there, because we've been hearing a lot about the Anfield nights in Europe and even at home, like home games in the league. Is that how true is that, or how does it manifest itself in terms of how you can feel it?
Well, again, Raf, you know, I mean, we saw on Tuesday night, it very much depends on the game. You know, I mean, yeah, I couldn't say Anfield's a cauldron at every waking moment in terms of the teams that play. The bigger the team, the bigger the atmosphere, the bigger the tension, you know, in terms of the game. I very much think that Liverpool's stadium, because it is quite a tight stadium, the crowd are very much on top of the players, so you do feel it. You're not that far away from the crowd, so especially on the east side and the west side, so you're very much in touching distance of the crowd, and so it does add to a very uncomfortable, hostile environment, especially if you're the opposing team. At Manchester City found out last year, and Barcelona found out on Tuesday. So it is very much a cold, and especially on big nights, and we saw that with Barcelona on Tuesday, you know.
Yeah, and even going back to the first leg against Barcelona, obviously the away fans would have travelled over. How do you find the difference then between, say, the home contingent and then the ones that regularly travel away?
Well, that's a very good question. I mean, I was talking to Peter Smith. He's a Drimmener guy, and I've got a podcast. I'm doing a little video podcast with him and a local boy called Adri, actually. And we were talking about this before the game. Peter, I actually agree with Peter Smith. I mean, he thinks that a lot of the fans that are actually go to Barcelona are kind of a bit of a renter crowd, you know. They're very flip-floppy, if you want to say it. They're not as committed as say, I wouldn't say all Liverpool fans, but there's a very different mentality over here in Spain. It very much goes with the wind, and it was very much feeling like Barcelona was very much a sort of a kind of a Hollywood club, you know, kind of a celebrity club, and you've got all these people in the stadium who would just, you feel like, were there just to watch the game, but wouldn't be there the next week, you know?
Yeah, of course, the decision, well, it's not really a decision, but the thing that people are asking in terms of Liverpool fans like yourself, the Premier League obviously hasn't been won in 29 years. The Champions League is something, there's a long history of winning, and it doesn't feel as much of a novelty because you only have to go back to 2005 for the last win. For you personally, obviously you'd love both, but are you of that mind where you kind of go, I want the Premier League more than the Champions League?
I'd love the Premier League, but but I'm pretty fatalistic, you know. I mean, I was feeling Sunday Brighton would have to have the game of their life, you know. They would have to be, it'd have to be their cup final, and I don't think they would want to do Liverpool any favours, to be honest. I mean, I wish the City were playing a little bit more tougher opposition, because I really think Pep Guardiola is not going to be like, you know, be like Valverde or Barcelona and not just turn up and expect to win. But, you know, football is like this, Rafa. We've seen this week with both Liverpool and Tottenham, you know. It's the surprise element. This is why we love the game. It's such a, you know, you really can't predict. You really can't say what's going to happen. Hand on my heart, I would love Liverpool to win. My head, unfortunately, says that it's going to be City's title. But, you know, again, you know, if Liverpool, as I said in the Real Madrid podcast with you last year, you know, if Liverpool can come away with one trophy, I think that's been a great success. If we don't come away with anything, then, it would feel a bit of a deflation, you know. But I'm optimistic, Raph, but I'm not sort of, you know, saying that we're going to do it. Who knows in football, as we found out this week, you know.
Yeah, I suppose a final question for you before we let you go. If, as you said, Liverpool don't win anything, it's going to be deflating. But pitching it longer term, the strength of this team and how far they've developed, I would be fairly optimistic they are going to win a number of different trophies over the next wee while.
Well, I'd like to think so, Raph. You know, I mean, I think, as I said last year to you, you know, I mean, Jurgen Klopp's building something here. I mean, I was talking about the game, you know, I was talking to the Anfield Rap lads, you know, Craig Hannon, Gareth Edwards, and John as well, the lads who do the Liverpool podcast. They're actually not that, they're a little bit sanguine like me, you know, they want to win something, but they know they're building something far more important for the future, you know, and I think that's the glass half empty, half full sort of thing. Of course, you know, I want Liverpool to win something this year. You know, you've got to live in the present. But as you say, you know, if you compare Liverpool to other teams, and I'm not going to name them, and you think you know who I'm talking about here, we are building something that I think that's going to be there for the next, we'd like to think, 5 to 10 years. But and I think that's down to the structure of the club. It's down to the manager, the mentality of the manager. He leads from example. The attitude of the players, they don't get ahead of themselves. I think this is the bedrock of any successful football club. And I think if we don't do it this year, then sure, you know, we are going to do it sooner rather than later, you know.
Yeah, I'm not sure if I could get used to a Liverpool era of dominance from the way I kind of grew up.
You know, everything's cyclical, isn't it? You know, I mean, United had that 20 years, and there was moments between broken up between Arsenal and Chelsea. But look, you know, I mean, football is cyclical. I mean, if you'd asked me back in 19 as a young teenage boy, to say, you know, it would be 30 years or more that Liverpool would win the Premier League. I mean, again, as I said to you hitherto at the beginning of the program, I would have called the funny farm and wheeled you off. But here we are, 2019, you know, so it's been a long, long wait. Let's hope we do it. But if we don't do it this year, I'm hoping that it'll be the next couple of years anyway.
Yeah, well, I'd be pretty optimistic it will happen. But Marcus Maher, obviously, as I billed you at the beginning, biased Liverpool fan. Thanks a million for taking the time to chat to me.
I don't want to say we're biased, but we're just, you know, passionate, I guess, you know.
Biased. I know you well enough. It's biased.
Yeah, you do. Well, Raph, good morning. Grazie a mio.
All right. Thank you. Cheers.